asleep, which is in the living room and is adjacent to the wall where my front door is right with me where my head is.
Okay, so you sleep out here closer to the street?
Yes, sir.
Is there a reason that you were sleeping on your couch?
Yes, sir. I have fibromyalgia, and which deals with a lot of pain.
You're just more comfortable out there?
Yes, I don't sleep there now, but I did for many years.
Was there an event occurring in the street or across the street that morning that caught your attention?
Oh, yes, sir. Loud voices.
Tell us, please, as much as you can about that event.
All right. I was not sleeping, but, you know, pretty much resting when I heard an argument. And I heard someone say, "This is not your effing house," and continue with that. It seemed like they were at the door, but somehow, because I wasn't looking out all the time, they had somehow moved in front of the garage door, which was basically where I couldn't see as well because there was a car here.
Let me stop you there.
Sure.
When you first hear this, do you look out?
Not exactly. No, I don't believe I did. Very, in a very little while I did, but only when it got louder and I was getting more concerned. But
as it got louder, did you perceive that the voices were getting closer to you? The reason I ask is you say it sounded like it was first up by the front door and then later it was by the garage door, and I'm trying to figure out.
No, I'm sorry. I didn't express that right. Sorry, sir.
Okay.
No. I did see them at one person, which I thought was the white haired, not Wayne, but the other. I forget his name again.
Ray. Okay.
Yes. I believe it was him. I never heard him speak before. Being in the same family, I don't know if he sounds the same as Wayne, but the voice sounded like Wayne.
Okay.
But it looked like Ray because of the gray hair.
Let me clear this up. Did you see Wayne outside?
At that particular time, for that 1 second I looked down, I think I was just focused on that one figure that I saw.
Okay. And that person that you saw was Ray of Great Lawn.
I was definite when I, at the time, but of course you...
I know it's been a long time.
Yes.
It's okay. It's okay. You don't need to be nervous today.
Thank you, sir.
So you see who you believe to be Ray Greenlaw out there.
Yes, sir.
And you hear him say, "This is not your effing house." Except he didn't abbreviate. He said the word, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And I'm assuming it was him. It was his house.
Okay. How many other people did you see out there with Mr. Greenlaw when you looked?
Well, I saw figures, but I'm not sure. Sir.
Okay. Do you think it could have been as many as two people?
Oh, there had to be at least two people, possibly three.
And do you recall what those people were doing as Mr. Greenlaw was saying this?
No, sir, because I looked out the window and just couple of second increments at a time.
Okay. The first time that you saw them, they were where?
By the door. The door where they live.
And that's when you hear this loud statement of, "This is not your effing house," right?
I thought so, sir.
Okay. I'm not challenging you. I'm trying to put it in perspective a little bit for the jurors. I'm not challenging you. Do you hear any other lower voices, like the argument is continuing, maybe?
Yes, I can hear lower voices.
Okay, and you think the argument might be continuing?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
do you hear any other raised voices, to the extent that you can pick up words?
I'm sorry, sir?
Did you hear any other words distinctly during this argument?
Yes, what scared me was I heard, but this was more when they were toward the garage door, do you want me to tell you what I heard there?
Yeah, so first it's over by the front door, then it's moved now to the garage door. Still arguing. What do you hear when they're over by the garage door?
I heard someone say, "I have a 45 and somebody else later say I did too.
After you hear those phrases, do you hear any more argument? Do you hear any more low voices? Any words you can pick up distinctly?
I can hear voices, but yes.
But nothing you can identify distinctly?
Nothing.
Okay. From start to finish, mm-hmm. how long did this argument last?
Well, sir, it's hard to put that in perspective because of how you're feeling, but to me it felt like a long time.
It's scary, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. When you're awakened in the middle of the night, people are yelling, you're scared.
Yes, especially when they talk about guns.
Yeah. And it wasn't just talk about guns, you actually heard gunshots.
Yes, that's right.
Can you put those into context for us, when you heard the gunshots in the sequence?
You mean like how long?
Yeah. Or in what order? Either how long or what order?
I just know there was a lot of them. That's all I remember. And I remember crouching in the hallway, shaking.
And can you tell us anything about the time gap between the end of the argument and all of these gunshots?
You mean like when the gunshots ended, sir?
Yeah, or even when they started or when they ended, anything at all to help us kind of hone in a little bit.
Seems like there was a few at first, maybe just a short while, and then a whole lot of them. That's what I remember.
Thank you, Ms. Cassidy. I don't have any other questions. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, sir.
Examination by counsel for defendant Wayne Greenwald.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. It sounds like good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Do you remember me?
I'm trying to. You look a little familiar.
Well, you identified me as one of the guys out there on the street here a second ago. I know you couldn't see there, but...
Yeah, I just thought it.
I'm Mr. Lawrence. I have spoken with you on a number of occasions in the past, and I represent Wayne Greenlaw, and we have spoken several times over the last 3 years. And so I'm going to be asking you some questions, and I'm going to ask you to look at some questions. Okay?
Yes, sir.
All Your Honor, may I approach the witness?
You may.
Ms. Townsend, I'm going to show you some pictures. Your Honor, may I just go and do a moment of her and show her the pictures?
You may.
No, ma'am, you are doing just fine. Thank you very much. Do you recognize that house?
Yes,
it's
my house.
Okay. And you are looking at a photograph that has been marked. So that's the death at the Houston there. And that is your house, is it not?
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, you spoke to us earlier in reference to a question from Mr. Will about where you were sleeping. And Lauren, before we do that, I'm going to show you another picture, which is marked as defendant's exhibit G. And would you say that's just a slightly different angle of your house as well?
Yes. Yes, sir.
All right, very good. And these pictures were taken several weeks ago, but going back to the night of October 28th and the morning hours of October 29th of 2011, has your house or that tree out there in your yard, has any of that changed?
You mean, was that tree there at the time?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir, it was.
All right, so the tree was there.
Mm-hmm.
Have you painted the house or anything since then?
It was painted, but I can't tell you when it was.
Okay. All right. Now, these two pictures show the front of your house, shot from the street. Mm-hmm. Can you...
That's right, you said it's your...
Oh, that's one more. Okay. You indicated that near your door, you were sleeping in the couch, and that right by that couch was a window.
No, sir, I'm sorry if I said that, if I said it wrong. If anybody can hear me. This is the front door, right here.
Yes, ma'am.
And my couch was against the, I won't mark it, I'll just show you.
Well, that's what I was going to give you, and you show me kind of from the outside rear.
The wall is very close, because I have a closet here. So figure the wall is about right here, for the edge.
All right, what did you draw it there? Is it a little line there that just kind of indicates where your wall is?
Probably like right.
All right, there you go.
Now, my couch is leaning against the wall this way.
Okay.
And my head was toward this door.
All right. Now, you indicated at some point in time you looked out. What did you look out of?
My window.
Circle that, please.
Yes, and probably sometimes I looked out here.
All right, I just draw it all the way around the window, so...
All the way around.
Yes, ma'am.
Like
all there,
this?
Yes, ma'am, there you go. All right, and could you do the same thing to the window, same window in the other photograph? Draw a circle.
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am, all there. All right, thank you very much. All right.
You're welcome.
Now, I'm going to show you what has been marked as Defendant's Exhibit H. Recognize the house that's in that picture?
Yes, that's the green moss house.
All right. And does this photograph appear to substantially show the green moss house in the same shape or condition that it was back in 2011 in October?
I would say so, sir.
All right, very good. And this is, I didn't identify this as Defendant's Exhibit H for identification. Right, Your Honor, I would ask that these be introduced as defendants next, whoever they are.
No objection.
The very first one, you never gave us a letter. So we have G and H as the last two. What was the first letter? And because this is a defendant's joint exhibit, you have no objection either, correct?
Correct, Your Honor.
All right. Defendant's Exhibit F for identification will be admitted as Defendant's Exhibit Number 9, G is Number 10, and H is Number 11.
Your Honor, may I publish these to the jury?
You may.
All right. All right. You want to try this again? That was the first one. Ms. Hauser, can you see that photograph?
Yes, sir.
And do you recognize the circle that you drew around the window?
Yes, sir.
And is that the window that whenever you were asked by Mr. Will earlier if you had a few occasions to look out the window, is that the window you looked out of?
Yes, sir.
All right, and your house, do you see that map that's right there behind you to your right-hand side, that big aerial photograph map? There is a light laser there. Can you point out your house on that map?
I'm not very good at maps.
That's all right. All right. What color is your house? Can we go to the next picture? All right, so Ms. Housley, this particular photograph you marked with two different things. One is a circle, and does that circle indicate the window again in which you looked out of?
Yes, sir.
And the line that you have drawn over there by the door, the vertical line that's going up and down, what does that represent inside your house?
That represents possibly just about where the wall is.
Okay.
There's a closet right there besides the door, but the wall is right there, and right beside that is where I slept.
All right, so you have a couch that runs along that wall?
I did, yes, sir.
All right, and you were sleeping on the couch?
Yes, sir.
All right, very good. Can you go to the third floor? And you identified this photograph as a photograph of Mr. Greenlaw's house, looking at Mr. Greenlaw's house from the front of it, and you live right across the street then, right?
Yes, sir.
All right, very good. We're going to leave this one up there, okay? All right. On the morning that all of this took place, Ms. Housley, can you tell me, if you can recall, and if you don't, then we'll try to assist, at or about what time it was that these events were taking place over there where you heard the noise?
I believe, sir, it was probably between 5 and 5:30, maybe more. At one point, I did see 5:30 on the clock.
All right, I have...
a copy of a transcript of the statement that you gave to Deputy Horton on the morning of October the 29th of 2011. Do you remember a deputy coming over to your house and interviewing you that morning?
Yes, sir, I do.
And was that deputy a male or a female?
He was a male, I believe.
All right. And if you would look, Ms. Housley, at the top on page 4, line 2, 3, 4, and 5, did you identify to the deputy what time you believe that you heard the arguing?
I really don't recall what we talked about. But if he asked me, I'm sure I told him.
Well, would you do me a favor, please, and would you, to yourself, read lines 2, 3, 4, and 5, just to yourself.
I can't say that I recall that. I'm sure if he asked me, that's what I said.
Okay. And your memory of these, now this is three and a half, almost 3.5 years later, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
And the deputy spoke to you that morning at 10:26 a.m., roughly 4 hours after this event occurred. Do you think your memory would have been better back then, or would it be better today?
I would think it would be better back then.
All right, very good. And so whatever you told the deputy back then, as opposed to what you're saying today, is probably more reliable. Is that the case?
I would say that, sir.
All right, very good. So what you told the deputy back then was that you heard the arguing at 5:35 a.m.
I remember looking at the clock about 5:30, so I don't know if that was, it seems in my mind I thought that was, but like I said, I guess my memory would have been better then, but in my mind's eye, it seems like I looked at it somewhere in between this ordeal, but I think what you're saying must be right.
Well, not what I'm saying, it's just what? This is what you told the
deputy.
It
makes sense.
Right?
Yeah, it makes sense, sir.
Okay, very good. Now, when you heard arguing that morning, I think you indicated to us that you heard someone say something about not wanting somebody in the house or get out of my house. Do you recall saying that or hearing that?
The exact words were, this is not your house.
And I believe if you will look on pages, on the same page, lines 13 down through 18, that you tell the deputy that in fact that they repeated that three consecutive times. You don't, this is not your effing house, this is not your effing house, not your effing house. Three times I heard that, you recall. And even if you don't recall, would you agree with me that more than likely what was said by you to the deputy back in on October the 29th of 2011 in this deposition is probably more accurate than your memory here today?
Yeah.
All right, very good. When you heard those three times, at that point in time, you indicated to the deputy that you looked out the window. Did you look on line 16 of that same page and see if that in fact is the case?
Where it says, and I, when I looked out the window, I believe not positive, but I think it is. Okay.
Yes, and so at that point in time, after you heard the, this is not your effing house, you looked out the window and you saw someone and you thought you recognized that person, did you not?
Yes, sir.
And what was it about that person that you thought that you recognized?
The thing that came to my mind is that it had to be Ray because of the stature, and I thought his hair was lighter.
And as a matter of fact, you indicated that to the deputy, did you not? That you knew Wayne was taller than the person that you saw, and that the person you saw was shorter than Wayne and had gray hair. Is that correct?
That was my perception, sir, yes.
Very good. Would you flip the page, please? Now, Mr. Will asked you if you could remember how many other people that you saw, and you seem to be a little bit unsure about that. Could you look at line 5 and line 6 on page 5 and just kind of read it?
Line 5 and 6?
Yes, ma'am, line 5 and 6 on page 5. Yes,
ma'am.
Yes. Now, having had a chance to look back at
and the other two people I did not know. There was two people there, I did not know them.
All right, so you told Deputy Fortin that morning that in addition to seeing the shorter gray-haired brother,
you saw two other people that you did not know.
Yes, that's what I thought, sir.
All right, very good. And looking at line 8, Ms. Towsley, where did you see them at, the two men?
Yes, that's what I did. They were backing up. Oh, you mean like coming from the door?
So you saw them coming from the front door of the Greenlaw house across the street?
Could you repeat that, please?
Did you see them coming from the front door area of the Greenlaw house across the street from you?
What I remember is that they were outside by the door.
Yes, ma'am. You saw them outside by the door.
Yes.
All right, very good. And that's what you told the deputy, right?
Mm-hmm.
And did they appear to not be doing something? Did they appear to, you heard an argument, you heard the shorter of the two brothers say, this is not your effing house, this is not your effing house, this is not your effing house. Did they appear to be not heeding his warning?
In my thoughts, that's what I was thinking, that I was thinking, why are they leaving?
And as a matter of fact, you told the deputy that on line 10, did you not?
Yes, sir.
All right. And then, after you heard those three times, and the persons that were at the door weren't heeding the warnings, did you again hear, this is not your effing house? And if you would, please, before you answer that, look at line 14.
You want me to answer the question if they said that again?
Yes, ma'am. Did they say, did the shorter of the two persons again say, this is not your house? That would be on line 14, Ms. Townsend.
I'm sorry, I don't see that here, what you're saying, sir. It says, I'm assuming, now don't tell me, don't write this down because I'm just assuming, but I'm assuming it's the person that you know that was saying, this is not your house.
So, once again, on line 14, you tell the deputy that you heard someone say, this is not your
Yes.
All right. And in addition to that, starting on line 14 and line 15, at that point in time, you also told them that you heard someone say they had a 45.
Yes, sir.
And you heard someone else say, I do too.
Yes, sir.
All right. Looking, if you can recall any of these answers, Ms. Townsley, without me having to refer you to a line, I would prefer you say it, but if you can't, then I'll be glad to direct you to it.
Okay.
After you heard the part about I have the 45 and somebody says I do too, how did it appear the demeanor of the two people that were out the door? What were they doing that were out by the front door?
When I heard about the 45, sir, I believe that was in the driveway in front of the garage door.
Okay. So it had moved from the front door out to the driveway.
Yes, sir. I did not see them do that.
Okay.
But that's where they were at the time.
All right. And the reason that you didn't see them do that was because you would walk over to the window and look out briefly. And we've heard other witnesses say the same thing. And then you would go back, and then you would come back to the window again. So you weren't always looking out the window.
No, sir.
But you could always hear out there, too.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And when you did see what was going out there, do you recall telling the deputy that I heard, because the reason I say that is I heard mocking after that. Do you remember telling Deputy Gordon about mocking?
No, sir.
Would you look, please, at line 15 and 16, please?
That's what I have there, sir.
Yes. And that morning, that's what you told Deputy Gordon according to the transcript. And you go on to say that he had warned them several times and that they didn't seem to care. Do you see that down the lines 18 and 19? And 20 for that matter?
I said that, sir, because they weren't moving. They weren't doing anything about it.
And that's what I just read to you, came from lines 18, 19, 20. That's what it says. If that's what you told the deputy that morning.
Yes, sir.
And the investigator asked you a question, were they giving him a hard time?
I didn't see the people, you know, like I said, because the car was there. I would just think that they were stalling. I mean, they weren't not loud. The one that was yelling about the house was loud. The people, or one or two people who were there besides him, what I remember, they had lower voices.
Okay. Would you look down at line 24 and 25 on that same page last year, where the investigator says, were they kind of giving him a hard time, and flip it over to the next page? Let me help you with that, Ms. Townsend.
Yes.
And what was your response to that in the first line?
I said, yes, they were like, kind of like, or they weren't heeding his warning.
What was he telling them?
He was telling them, you know, I didn't hear those words, get off my property. I don't think I did, but the point was that they didn't want them there. And sir, just had a thought that went away. Excuse me for a minute, please.
All right, and if that morning, according to the transcript from the deputy, starting at lines 3 through lines 10, he was telling them, he being the shorter, gray-haired gentleman, telling them to get out, get off my property, get out, and they weren't.
Mm-hmm.
And they just kept coming. I saw a couple times they came toward him again. And the investigator asked him, did you see him yelling at them to get off his property? And do you see where you responded, yes, get off, this is not your effing house, get off my property, get out, get off. That's what I heard. Do you recall? Well,
I'm sorry that I don't have a memory for that.
I know you don't.
But I'm sure it's what, I know that I was very upset when I was talking to him, and I was very emotional. As far as when I look back now about just the facts, I can't remember that offhand, but I may, you know, if I said that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, shortly thereafter, according to your statement to the deputy that morning, you saw Wayne's white Jeep pull into the driveway.
I don't know one car from another, but I remember a car coming, and, yes, I do. That's what it was. It was coming, was it coming in the driveway or did it pull up in front of the house? Because it seems like I remember it pulled up in front of the house.
You know, I don't think you actually said that. But what you did say was that you saw the white Jeep pull up to the house.
I can't vouch for the white Jeep, but that's what I put there. I can't picture the white Jeep right now.
Right.
Sorry, sir.
And the point, and I know, and I'm probably belaboring this, but you had heard the yelling and all the stuff that was going on, and somebody says they heard whatever, and you saw a white Jeep pull up, but at some point, do you recall telling the deputy that you heard 3 shots right before the Jeep pulled in?
I don't know if it was the Jeep or not, but it sounds like it's coming back to me that could be correct. Like, I think so, because I think, in my mind, I was thinking they were warning shots.
Okay. And as a matter of fact, you said that in the statement that you've made, that you believe those to be warning shots.
Yes, sir.
And you said that by this time, they, referring to the other men, the two men, were down the street. But first of all, I heard three shots. And do you recall telling the deputy that, in fact, you heard those three shots?
Sir, I don't remember seeing them go down the street. I remember hearing those three shots. Maybe there was a little time in between before there was a whole bunch of them.
And you remember telling the deputy about the motion lights that Mr. Greenlaw had over there in his house and kind of how annoying they were to you?
Yes, and I believe they came on, and that's how I could see the gray hair on the...
All right, and you see that picture up there of the Greenlaw house?
Yes, sir.
Stacy, could I get you to just drop that picture down just a touch so that the Greenlaw house is visible? Not much. Yeah, there, all right?
Yes, sir.
You see that little light over the garage there?
Yes, sir.
Did Mr. Greenlaw have a motion detector light on his house at that time?
I believe so, sir.
And do you recall talking to the deputy about that, and that you'd be laying in your couch at nighttime and, you know, some cat would run by and then the bright lights would wake you up, and it was kind of annoying, wasn't it?
Yes, sir.
And I believe you told the deputy that you never saw these people before, these two guys.
I never saw which guy?
You never saw these people, the two guys?
I didn't recognize any of those two. It turned out that I knew the one that got killed because he was on the corner. I knew where he lived because when I used to ride my bike by there, sir, I would see him.
Okay. But at the time when you gave the statement to the deputy, you didn't realize that he was one of those two people out there?
That's correct, sir.
Okay. And you didn't recognize the other one?
No, sir.
And you go on and tell the deputy again that you again heard, this is over on page 14, Ms. Pouncey, that you again hear the shorter of the two tell the gentleman to get off my property. That would be lines 2, 3, and 4. Page 14, top of the page, lines 2, 3, and 4. You see that? It says, you told them to get off my property. They weren't taking it serious.
Yes, sir. That was my impression, sir.
All right. Ms. Towsley, it's been very nice seeing you again.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome, sir.
I don't have any questions.
Were you examination, Mr. Will?
Yeah, I just have one question.
Let's put the lights back out, please.
Ms. Towsley, I just wanted to ask you one quick question here. I don't know if you remember, so I'm going to turn to the page directly to you. Page 5, lines 8 and 9 and 10.
It's in what?
Do
I read that now?
Okay. Yeah, you had a chance to read it out. Not out loud, just to yourself.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. Did you read it to yourself?
Can
you repeat page 5? Okay, lines 8, 9, and 10. No problem. 5, 8, 9, and 10. All right. All right. With all of this other stuff going on, mm-hmm. At some point, do you remember telling the police that you saw the two men backing out of the house of the defendants?
I can't recall it in my mind, but if I said that, it would, like you said, it was fresh in my mind then.
Okay, and are you in fact reading that exact thing right there?
Yes, sir.
Basically, it says, I saw two men on foot at the door, and they were backing out.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. I appreciate it very much.
Chairman, may I readdress that?
That particular point only. Yes, sir.
And in the next line, Ms. Housley, 24 and 25. You, matter of fact, you continue on with the sentence, don't you? So the two males were standing at the front door and backing out. They were, they kind of giving him a hard time. That's the completion of that sentence, was it not?
Steve, I can write it wrong. Page 5.
Yes.
8, 9.
Well, Judge, it's the same issue. You, on page 5, down at the bottom there, you, up the top, you say you saw them back in the console.
Oh, page 5.
I saw Mr. Will was referring to the lines down at the bottom. He was referring to these up here.
Yes, sir.
But you say the same thing down here, don't you? In lines 20,
but as far
1,
as
22, 23, 24, and 25, that they were at the front door backing out.
Yes.
But they were giving him a hard time.
My saying that may have been the whole, you know, the whole picture that they were giving a hard time. At this particular time, sir, I believe they were backing out. Yes, I remember that now. But I shut the curtain. You know, I only, you know, for a little bit. So I really don't know, sir.
Okay, you would agree with me that's what the transcript says.
Yes, but I'm really feeling that that's not at that time.
Okay.
That they were giving them a hard time and that they were leaving.
Very good.
No, I'm sorry.
Will Ms. Towsley be needed at any further time during the trial?
No, ma'am.
Would a defense counsel have any objection to Ms. Towsley being released from her subpoena? Mr. Valerino?
No, Your Honor.
Mr. Lawrence?
No, ma'am.
Right. Ms. Towsley, you are released from your subpoena, which means that you will not be recalled or required to come back to this trial. You are still subject to the court's instruction not to discuss what you testified here today with anyone other than the attorney. Other than that, you are free to go.
Yes, you may.
gentleman, we were talking about the remaining witnesses. There are two witnesses that were brought in this afternoon for potential testimony, but the council does not believe that we can conclude even one of those by 6. They wanted to go past 6, and I told them no. I told you we would go 8:45 to 6. There may be days in which we have to modify that in order to get through the trial, but I'm not going to do that on a Friday afternoon. So you're going to be released, subject to all my prior instructions. I can tell you, and I don't mean to do this with him not here, but he's the one who decided to leave. Mr. Frank Fernandez from the News Journal has been here the majority of the day. Usually when he's in the courtroom, there's going to be an article in the newspaper. And the only reason I'm telling you that is if you get the newspaper, you need to be very, very careful not to read anything about this. It might be best that you not read the newspaper at all, or have a family member give you all the sections where there's nothing about a trial in it. It may or may not be there. Just know he's been here all day. They also have an online version, so please be careful and don't go looking at News Journal online over the weekend for all the reasons that we previously discussed. Now, research about anything about the case over the weekend, and don't talk to friends or family member about anything. The only thing you can tell them is, yes, I'm on a jury, and I have to go back on Monday. That includes not saying how you feel about being on this jury. It does. You can indicate that you're on this jury, you go back, but you can't talk which case, what it's about, or how you feel about it. That would violate that instruction I gave you a couple of times, both at the beginning of jury selection and also at the beginning of trial today. We will start at 8:45 on Monday morning, so I would ask that you be here no later than 8:45. We can't really bring in the jury until everyone's here, so if you could get here 8:40 or so, make sure Deputy Merchant comes out a few minutes early, takes roll, as you know, brings you back here, drop off personal items, bring them out here, sit down at 8:45, and we can start. That would be our preference. Again, our schedule next week will be 8:45 to 6. A few times it will be before 6, and to the extent that we go up past 6, I'll try to keep that to a minimum. Does anybody have any questions they feel they need to answer before we come back on Monday morning? All right, you are excused. Bring in both Ms. Fitzgerald and Mr. Madison. I'm going to have them sworn in and advise them of the rule, and then I will address the scheduling issue with them. Will you start with Mr. Madison on Monday under the circumstances? I know that wasn't your preferred order, but I just want to address that.
At this point, I will do whatever's convenient. I feel very
I'll let you decide that, then I won't tell them
okay.
When that is.
Yeah.
If we could call in Marianne Fitzgerald and Kurt Madison.
You want to come up to the podium, Marianne?
Yes.
Thank you.
I'm going to have both of you sworn in to be witnesses in this case. If you please raise your right hand and face the clerk.
Do each of you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you shall give in this cause will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Yes.
Thank you.
First, I want to instruct you on a procedural rule called the rule of sequestration. What that means is now that you have been sworn to be a witness in this case, you may not discuss your testimony with anyone other